Solidity 0.6 is out and it's time to have an in-depth look about what changes were made to the language itself. Instead of going through the changes here in the Solidity document and read them off, I actually want to do an in-depth look at what happened in Solidity. And this is why I have a couple of Solidity files here in Remix, and you can download them in the video. Below the video is a description or as a resource download and follow along. So the first thing that I want to talk about is the new virtual keyword, which is functions can now only be overwritten when they are either marked with the virtual keyword or defined in an interface. Functions without implementation outside an interface have to be marked virtual. When overriding a function or modifier, the new keyword override must be used. When overriding a function or modifier defined in multiple parallel bases, all bases must be listed in parentheses after the keyword, like so override base 1, base 2, or the other way around. There are a couple of questions that popped up in my mind when I read about this. Let's have a look at the first one, the new override and the virtual keyword. So when I switch over here to Solidity 0.5.15, then this smart contract works just fine. But as soon as I add the new virtual keyword, Solidity 0.5.15 cannot really do anything with this. It gets an error. So the first question that I had, that I asked myself, is when I have a function in Solidity 0.6.0 and I use the virtual keyword, does the function signature of the compiled smart contract still stay the same? And that's fairly easy to test. So I'm going to just to compile this one over here with 0.6.0. I'm going to copy the bytecode. I'm going to copy it over here into a text editor. And then I'm going to add the virtual keyword, because sometimes it's just a language feature. I compile this again and see how that changes. And in fact, the source code, the bytecode, the compiled source code changed a little bit. I didn't deep dive into what exactly changed. I was just interested if the signature of the or the bytecode changes at all, or if this is just a language feature that you have to mark your functions as virtual. So yes, you have not only to mark it as virtual, it's also changing the bytecode. Let me get this a little bit closer look up to see what changed here. So over here, you can see that it slightly changed the signature from, I think from here on somewhere. And well, small parts changed. So yes, the next thing is, how does this override really works? Let's have a look at how this worked in Solidity 0.5.15, and then how this looked like in, how it looks like now in Solidity 0.6.0. So I'm going to switch over to Solidity 0.5.15, and I have two parts in my code here. One is uncommented, works in Solidity 0.5.15, and one is commented, works in 0.6.0. So I'm first trying this one out, and I comment this out, and I uncomment the other one, and then we are going to see the difference. So the way it worked so far in Solidity 0.5.15 is, I have a contract A. This has some event and the function. And in my function, I'm going to emit a string called from A. And then I have a contract B and the contract C. The contract B, the same function, does nothing. And in my contract C, I'm going to extend the contracts A and B. And the order is very important. So we are going to override first contract A and then contract B. So essentially, our function A here, which is calling then super function A or fun A, shouldn't do anything. So let's give this a try. Let's run this over here. Have to be careful which contract you are selecting. I'm going to select the contract C. And when I hit fun A, then we see which events were emitted. And we see it is just this one event from B, because super fun function A is doing nothing. And if you're changing the order over here, BA, then we are first overriding B, and then after that, we are overriding A. So A is the most recent function that is overridden. So we are going to, when we call super fun A, then we are calling super fun A in contract A over here. Let's redeploy contract C and then click on fun A. And we see that we have our two events over here. First from our contract C, this one, from B, the string is important. And then we have from our super fun A, from our event from the function A. Now let me comment this out and then let's comment the other one in, which is now in 060. In 060, again, I have my three smart contracts. I have a contract A, and this time I'm going to mark my function, my fun A, as virtual. So Solidity knows that it can be overridden. In my contract B, I'm also marking this as virtual. And now comes the interesting part in contract C. I'm not only going to say this is derived from B and A and the order, but also the function A itself needs to specify the order it's overriding. So I have this override keyword and then the smart contracts that it's used to override. And in this case, I'm changing the order here. So what is interesting for me is now, does the order for the function override being used from this one over here or from this one over here? And as you can guess already which one it is, but I'm still going to deploy this. I have to select the right compiler and compile, deploy my smart contract and call function A. Now we have two events, one from here and one from over here. Let's change the order over here. Redeploy the smart contract. And we see it is going to stay the same. It doesn't matter what order you have here. What is important is that you have the correct order over here. Now we have just one event from our function here in the contract C, and the event in the contract A is never fired. Right on to the next one. Member access to length of arrays is now always read-only. Even for storage arrays, it is no longer possible to resize storage arrays assigning a new value to their length. Use push, push value, or pop instead, or assign a full array, which will of course override existing content. The reason behind this is to prevent storage collisions by gigantic storage arrays. Now let's give it a try how this looked so far. Let me just reload my remix here. Go to my second example. Again, switch over to 0.5.15 and start with the old version before we're gonna go into the new version. In the old version, we could do the following. When we are going to add a new element, we could increase the length of the array by one, and then just write on the new created element the number that we want to, the value that we want to write there. So we write the new key to the new value. And if you want to remove an element from the end, then in the previous version, we could just decrease the length and it will automatically delete one of the elements at the end of the array. How does this work? This works as the following. If I deploy my smart contract and I'm trying to access the first element, I get an error. I'm gonna add, well, an integer over here. Then I can see that I get back my, well, the integer that I just assigned to my array. And then when I remove it, and all works fine. And if I try to access again the first element of the array, it gives me an error again. So that works all fine. And if I'm trying to do the exact same thing in Solidity 0.6.0, then it will tell you it cannot do this. There is a member length is read only. So let's just comment this one out and comment the other one in. This is how the new version works, and it's working in both 0.5.15 and 0.6.0. So I have the same array, and I'm going to use push to push a new value onto the array, and pop to pop one array value off the array and reduce the size by one. Let's just give this a try. I'm gonna deploy the smart contract over here. I can, well, get an error when I try to access the first element, and I'm gonna try to add an element. This works fine. I'm gonna read the element. So I'm getting back my integer that I just stored. And then I remove the element again, works also fine. And then when I try to read the first element again, I get the same error. Then I want to skip a couple of things that are not so interesting. The next one that I quickly want to talk about is state variable shadowing is now disallowed. A derived contract can only declare a state variable X if there is no visible state variable with the same name in any of its bases. Let's have a look how this looks like. So what we can do is, let's try that one with 0.5.15. All right, we have a contract A, and this has a state variable X, and that is 1, 2, 3. Then we could have a contract B, which derives from A the same one, is overriding more or less the same state variable X with a new value. Now, if I'm going to select a new compiler, then it will tell you it cannot do this because the identifier is already declared and you're not allowed to do that. So when you're going to use the new version 0.6.0 and go down, then you can see that as long as there is no visibility in the new smart contract, then you can very well do that, and it just lets you compile this. All right, on to the next one. The next one that I want to talk about that I really found is very useful is the new receive function. So previously we had a fallback function without a name. It was an unnamed function. And this was split up now into a new fallback function that is now defined using the fallback keyword. So it gets a real keyword and a receive ether function defined with the receive keyword. So let's give this a try. A fallback function over here, and that is something that I just did for 0.6.0. So I'm going to emit one event in the receive function just to see how the fallback function is called in combination with this fallback button over here from Remix, because there is no receive button. So this kind of confused me at the beginning a little bit, but it's very, very straightforward. So when I'm going to send 12 way to my smart contract, then a quick guess which one of the one is going to be called. It's going to be the receive function automatically, because we are not sending any message data along. It's going to emit this event, which emits the message sender address and the amount. So the message sender address is my account over here, and the amount is 12 because I sent 12 way. And if we are going to send some call data along and some way, then it should trigger a revert automatically because our fallback function is not payable. And if we are not sending any way along, then it's just going through because our fallback function doesn't do anything. The last one that I want to talk about is the new try catch statement. That is kind of really interesting because it kind of turns out that you can catch errors. And with that, I had the feeling that atomicity of transactions are not given anymore. So when you can catch errors from external function calls, then in your external function call, there is a problem, then it kind of is like going back to this low level function calls with call data, call value, where you can check if the return boolean is either true or false. And I found this kind of interesting that you can do this now with actual external function calls. So let me give this a try over here. I also have no 0.5.15 example, because in 0.5.15 it just didn't work this way. And I just want to give you an example of how it looks like in the new Solidity 0.6.0. So I have a contract A, and I have three different failures that can happen over here. I have one function A require failure. So that's going to send require false and an error string. I have a function B revert failure. So that's going to call a revert. And I have a function C assert failure. It's going to have an assert false, and assert doesn't take any error strings at the moment. All right, then I have a contract B, which has a contract A instance, creating a new instance of contract A in the constructor. And then it has one function called test require try catch. And in this case, it's for now, it's calling try instance E, function A require failure. And then it has these catches. And for me, it's going to be interesting what kind of event is going to be emitted. Because we have two different events. The one is an error event that I defined over here, and the other one is a low-level error event. And I want to see which kind of error is going to be in which branch of the catch statement. So let's give this a try. I'm going to remove this one over here. And contract B is the one we want to deploy. So deploy that one. And I'm going to try this. You see that we are just returning a false over here, so we don't get an error for our transaction. You have to be careful about that, extremely careful about that. So you might want to think about how you handle errors and how you try and catch those errors. Just it gives us a lot of new opportunities to have bugs in our smart contracts. And over here, we have the event error that is emitted. So in this case, it's going into this error branch of the catch statement, and it's emitting an event called error over here. So let's give it a try with the other function, the revert failure function. Gonna save this, gonna deploy this smart contract and give this a try. So we are also having an error event. It is also going into this, this part of the catch statement. Oh, this was the wrong button. It's gonna be this one. So let's try the assert failure or the evaluation of false of an assert statement. And this is going to give us the low level error. And currently there is no reason given. It is just, empty. But it's going to be the low-level error event that is being emitted. Yeah, then are a couple of new features that I don't want to talk about so much, but these were the ones that are really outstanding for me, especially in terms of development and introducing new ways of developing your smart contracts in combination with possible bugs and possible problems from a security standpoint. There's definitely a lot more things coming up. I'm going to be interested in that. And if you like this video, then subscribe to this channel. There's going to be a lot more of this. And I'll see you in the next videos.